Today's Bible character is one of my favorites. He is actually probably all of the Christian church's favorite character, and that is Jesus. And for a while now, we're going to be looking at different Bible characters that are all a part of Jesus's time while he was here with us on earth. Now, Jesus is a favorite Bible character because it is only because of him that we are able to meet together and to be able to learn more about God and to be forgiven of our sins. See, Jesus was God's son, and in the Bible, the books of Matthew and Luke tell a great job right in the very beginning of those two books about the start of Jesus's life, how he was born and the things that were going on when he was born. But Matthew and Luke do a great job of showing how God was a part of that right from the beginning, and how God had, they kind of helped us remember how God had reminded us way back hundreds of years before Jesus was born and telling people that Jesus was going to be coming. Now, the prophets didn't use the name of Jesus, but they said that God would send the one, the anointed one, the one who would come. And they told a lot of this to be on the lookout for this. So in the books of Matthew and Luke, they start right out of reminding us as we read it how God said that this would happen. And then they do a great job of showing us of how God was a part of Jesus coming and being born as a human for us. Now, Jesus being God's son means for us that he was fully God, being fully human. And so sometimes it can be kind of confusing to understand that. And so a lot of the gospel books, the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they tell the rest of the story of Jesus and his life here on earth in a way to help us to see that he was fully God, God's son here for us, but also that he was fully human. So he can understand what we're going through. He knows what we're a part of. He knows who we are and what we deal with. So Jesus, God's son, was sent for a specific purpose. Jesus came to be able to die on the cross to forgive us of our sins. And he rose again so that we have that forgiveness. But now we can also have the Holy Spirit, which is God with us. And having the Holy Spirit with us, first we're forgiven of our sins, but then our hearts are cleaned of the wanting ourself all the time and wanting our own way and wanting the things that make us happy. Instead of all that self being in charge of our hearts, now we can be washed and cleaned of those self things so that we can have God's love in us and we can live God's love for other people. So Jesus is a very, very important Bible character, but also real God with us that we can know and learn and love and become like. So Jesus is a very important character today, but he's also very real. He's not just a part of a story, but we are very grateful that these stories are written down so that we can read them and learn about them. Because I don't know about you, but I was not alive thousands of years ago to be able to experience this. So I'm grateful for the written stories that we can read about and learn about. So our focus today is on Jesus. But it's a very special, important part of Jesus because this is a story where we first learn that Jesus forgives sins. And it's a very surprising story. It's found in only two books of the Bible. It's found in, the one I'm going to be focusing on now is in Luke. So in Luke chapter 5, verses 17 through 26, we learn about how Jesus heals a man who is paralyzed. Now, this man is paralyzed he can't walk by himself. He cannot get to Jesus by himself. And so it's actually his friends who believe so strongly that he could be healed by Jesus that they pick up his mat and they carry his mat, kind of his rug blanket that he's laying on. They carry him to where Jesus is. Now, at this point of Jesus's life, we have been learning a whole lot in the books of the Bible, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, about how Jesus is going around healing people. He's healing them in their body sicknesses, in the things that are wrong with their bodies, whether they're blind or paralyzed or sick. He is healing their physical bodies so that they can be whole again and they can live life fully the way God had wanted them to live. And so he's healing all of these things, and he's freeing them from these things that are making their bodies not work the right way. And so this is what we see. And so they're bringing their paralyzed friend, their friend who cannot walk, to Jesus so that his body can be healed. And this is what we know of Jesus' ministry right now. But there's a special part of this story that makes it a little bit different than the other healing stories. We learn in Luke chapter 5, beginning in verse 17, that at this time, it wasn't just people who wanted to be healed who were around Jesus. It's a bunch of Pharisees. A bunch of Pharisees who came from the whole area of Galilee, which is a big chunk of land around in Israel, around where Jesus was ministering. But they also came from a big chunk of land of Judea and a big chunk of land of Jerusalem. So these Pharisees are a group of people who believe in God. And they want to follow God and do the right thing, because what they believe is if they do everything right that they're supposed to do, then God will send this special anointed one to make God's kingdom be everywhere and make all the bad stuff stop and make those bad Romans who are mean to us go away. This is their thinking. So they're thinking we need to obey every single thing so that God will send his anointed one, his special one who is set apart to make things right. And this is their thinking. So it comes from a love of God, but it comes from their love of God comes from a we need to obey all the rules perfectly. And if anybody doesn't obey it perfectly, then now God won't send his anointed one. So these Pharisees, even though they have a heart that loves God and wants to do the right thing, it has made them to stop loving people. Because instead, what they're doing is they're loving the rules and they're getting angry at people because the people aren't following the rules perfectly. And so it's kind of causing a problem for them. So when they hear that Jesus has come, now we believe that Jesus is God's son, his anointed one that he sent for us, but they're not seeing that. Because they're looking for it for a certain way that they pictured in their heads. And so when they hear about Jesus who has come and is healing all this, and everyone's starting to believe, wow, he's the anointed one, he's the Christ or the Messiah, he's the one who's supposed to come. Another phrase is the son of David. In other words, someone who is like that great king who loved God and who is going to come. So the people are starting to think, ooh, there's something special about Jesus. He's not just a man. There's something special. I wonder if he's the one. So the Pharisees get worried about this because they're like, whoa, wait a second. Not everybody's obeying the rules, and so this can't be the one, which means all of you people are believing something that's not true. We need to check this out. So that's why in Luke chapter 5, beginning at verse 17, we see that this is when the Pharisees, all these groups of Pharisees, they start to gather together and they come to where Jesus was because they want to figure out who this is and what's going on and why all these people are believing the wrong thing. So they want to check it out. Well, Jesus knows this. Jesus knows that they are there. He knows why they are there. And so this special healing is a little bit different. So remember, these friends of this paralyzed man, they carry him on his reed, his rug mat blanket that he is on. They carry him there because he can't walk there himself. However, when they get there, because of all of the crowds of people that are coming to get healed, all of the crowds of people that are coming to see, hey, what's going on? And the big, huge crowd of Pharisees that are there to double check and see who Jesus is and why people are believing the wrong thing. A big, huge crowd of people. And because of this big, huge crowd of people, the friends can't even get their friend close to Jesus so that he can be healed. And they know that he needs to get close. And they know, they believe Jesus can heal him. So they problem solve, what can we do? Well, we can't get through the door. And we can't get through the windows. And we can't push through the crowd because there's so many people. Let's go through the roof. And I love this story because of this. I have never forgotten this story since I was a little kid hearing about this because of this amazing part. They climb up onto the roof. They have steps to go up to the roof, I imagine, in my head. They get their friend, they lug him up, and they get him up on the roof, and then they create an opening in the middle of the roof, Now, I don't know if they had to like cut away at it, and so falling on top of Jesus and other people, or all these pieces of the roof falling down. I don't know. But it does say in Luke that they get through the tiles. So there's a way that they're able to move things around in some way that it creates a big, huge opening. And it's big enough that they can pick up their friend, who's a grown man, laying on his mat blanket. They pick him up, and they start to lower him down through the roof. And he comes, I love how Luke says it, right in front of Jesus. So Jesus is standing there talking and teaching, and all of a sudden down comes this man on a blanket. Everyone kind of stops listening, and he lands down there. And Jesus has compassion, and he says, "What is it that you want?" And I do believe, let me double check this right here. I want to make sure that I get it right. He lays on his mat right in front of Jesus. And Jesus sees how much these friends who are up on the roof believe. They believed so strongly that Jesus was who he said he was and that he could heal their friend. They believed so strongly in it that they opened up the roof to get their friend to him. And when Jesus sees how much they believe, Jesus looks at the friend who is lying on that mat and he says, "Your sins are forgiven." Now, this is a pretty strange part of the story because everyone's been coming to get their bodies healed. And instead, Jesus looks at this friend and says, "Your sins are forgiven." Now remember, sins are those rules of our self inside. When we know what we should do, the book of James says, but we don't do it. Instead, we choose our self way instead of God's way, and we choose it. It's our choice to do it. That separates us from God. And so Jesus looked, he says, "Your sins are forgiven. Those choices you have made of yourself instead of God's way that you knew, that is forgiven." So now you can stand before God. You can be close with God again because your sins are forgiven. And the Pharisees who are all there are like, "Oh my goodness, he can't say that. That's blasphemy." Now, blasphemy is a big, huge word that basically means talking bad about God's name. It is saying something wrong or untrue about God. So they're saying that is blasphemy. And the reason they think this in their head is because you can't forgive sins, only God can. Oh, this man. So they find what they are looking for, that this man in their mind is talking bad about God's name or saying things wrong about God. And so they are incredibly angry. They are incredibly bothered by this. But Jesus knows what they are thinking. And I believe, the Bible doesn't say this, but I believe that's why he said in the first place, "Your sins are forgiven." Because everyone was here expecting God to heal a body, but instead he healed what was truly wrong. Yes, our bodies have sicknesses and our bodies hurt and our bodies might not work right. And God wants to heal those things for us. He wants us to be made full and whole the way he wanted us to be made in the first place. But it's our sin. It's our self-choices that truly separate us from what God has wanted us to truly be, which is being made in his image, being able to live out his love in the world. And so this is what is truly needing to be healed. And Jesus shows this by saying it in the first place. But these Pharisees get upset, and Jesus knows that they're missing the true thing that needs to be healed. So Jesus looks at the Pharisees and he says, "So that you will know that the Son of Man," in other words, God's Son, me, the anointed one who's supposed to come and is here, "so that you will know that I have the authority to forgive sins." And then he turns to the man before he finishes his sentence, and he looks at the man on the mat and he says, "Get up and walk." And the man stands up. The man who could not walk stands up, grabs his mat, and goes off praising God. And everyone around sees this amazing thing that happened, and they say, "Oh, oh my goodness." And they start to praise God. And they start to glorify God. That means give a true opinion of God. And they start to glorify him. Everyone's praising God, and God's name is held true. So what this story means to me is these friends believed so strongly that they did everything they could to get their friend before Jesus. But the true thing is because my favorite Bible character is Jesus, this shows us, just like it showed the Pharisees and just like it showed those who were watching, we can believe this story because it was true. This shows us that yes, what we see with our eyes, those amazing miracles that we read about in the Bible, the seeing of the healing of this man who could now suddenly stand up and walk, what we see helps us to believe what we can't see. That Jesus truly did come to forgive us of our sins, that we can believe our sins are forgiven because these things that they could see truly happened, so we can believe the things that we can't see truly happen. Jesus did come to forgive us of our sins. He does forgive us of our sins. And that's what truly needs to be healed so that we can be filled with God's love and we can live God's love now in our hearts that are getting cleaned. Jesus is an amazing man. He is God's son, and I believe in him. And it's belief in him that frees us truly from the sin that controls in our lives. So what we're going to do from now on is we're going to learn more and more about Jesus by seeing favorite Bible characters that are a part of Jesus' story that we can read about. Because what we can see helps us to believe what we can't see. And we can stand in it strongly and we can go off just like that man who was healed, praising God, and our lives can show others that they can praise God. So I hope you have a blessed week. I know today's story was maybe a little bit different, but I hope that it gives you hope and that you can believe in the things that you can't see because of the stories that God so wonderfully gave us through people who wanted to write it down. Have a blessed week. I am praying for you. If there's anything you want to share with me or any prayer requests that you would have, I'd love to either pray for you or praise with you. You can reach me at Pastor Sarah at PerryNazarene.com. Have a wonderful week.